Hello, everyone, and welcome to April's Metastatic Breast Cancer Impact Series event. My name is Casey Volpe, and I manage MBC initiatives here at Komen. The programming for the Impact Series is envisioned as a year-long conversation with attendees, where we present new topics, information, speakers every single month so that our audience is able to pick and choose what is valuable and important to them in their journey. Today, our topic is metastatic inflammatory breast cancer, and we have a phenomenal speaker with us today, Dr. Wendy Woodward. Before we dive in and I give her the floor, we're going to take a moment to thank our sponsors for supporting the 2024 MBC Impact Series. So our premier sponsors, AstraZeneca, Gilead, GE Healthcare, and Merck, and our signature sponsors, Walgreens and Daiichi Sankyo. So just a housekeeping note, while everyone's speaking and doing a phenomenal presentation, please post your questions in the Q&A feature in Zoom. We will get to as many as we can. We'll go right to time to try to get through as many questions as possible. And please keep in mind that our speakers can't provide individual medical advice. So just try to keep your questions general and we'll make sure we get you the best answers we possibly can. Now, we're excited you're joining us today. So to start, I have the privilege of introducing our moderator, Jamie LaScala. Jamie was diagnosed with stage 3 inflammatory breast cancer in 2015. A patient advocate board member for the Translational Center of Excellence in Breast Cancer at Penn Medicine, she is also Penn's patient advocate for the Translational Breast Cancer Research Consortium. She has served as a consumer reviewer for the Department of Defense Breast Cancer Research Program and an advocate reviewer for Komen, and is a member of the Komen Advocates in Science. She's a member of the American Society of Clinical Oncology's Breast Cancer Guideline Advisory Group and completed the National Breast Cancer Coalition's Project Lead. She has a BS from Thomas Jefferson University, having spent a semester at the University of Salamanca in Spain. Jamie, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Casey. I'm so happy to be here with everyone. As Casey said, I am a patient advocate and member of Komen Advocates in Science. I was diagnosed with stage 3 inflammatory breast cancer, triple positive in 2015. IBC often develops rapidly and can easily be confused with a breast infection. About 30% of IBC patients are diagnosed at stage 4. I greatly appreciate the focus Dr. Woodward and Komen are bringing to this aggressive subtype of breast cancer. Dr. Wendy Woodward is professor and interim chair of the Department of Breast Radiation Oncology at the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, Texas, where she is also executive director of the Morgan Welch Inflammatory Breast Cancer Clinic and Research Program. So I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Woodward now. I know she has some information she'd like to share with us. Dr. Woodward?
Super. Thank you so much. And it's great to meet you and really appreciate Komen as well putting this focus on metastatic inflammatory breast cancer. So I put together slides. I've tried really hard not to put 100 slides together and tell you every random fact in my brain. So we really leave some time to talk and get through questions and things that people are interested in. As a small disclaimer, I'll highlight I'm a radiation oncologist, and a lot of the management of metastatic inflammatory breast cancer focuses around medical oncology. So I won't get into the weeds of those therapies. I'm going to provide a big overview of where are we now and what's coming. So overall, I'm going to talk a little bit about inflammatory breast cancer diagnosis and how it contributes to part of the aggressiveness of IBC, some tools that we have to help patients get diagnosed, both the algorithm from MD Anderson, as well as the new Komen score. I'll talk about data we've been really churning through in our large registry population of our IBC patients to try to understand the best impression of the outcomes that we have right now, which is helping us to make sure that our trials are designed around the problems that patients really have and trying to improve those. And then I'll talk about current and developing agents and trials for metastatic breast cancer. The QR code here is to our landing page, which also has good basic information about inflammatory breast cancer trials, all of those kinds of things, if that's helpful. So let me minimize my, what is IBC? Probably everybody here knows this, but inflammatory breast cancer is a breast cancer that presents as a change in the breast skin. And that tends to be this sort of erythema. This is very classic looking, peau d'orange, the pores on the skin. But the problem is, it doesn't have to be this classic, I hope obvious and easy to diagnose breast cancer. Sometimes it can be very varied and very different in different skin tones. And so we really need to continue to raise awareness about some of that variety. It's about 2-4% of breast cancer. So not common, not rare necessarily, but not common. But because it's diagnosed late, because of the resistance to therapies in some cases, it disproportionately represents a large fraction of breast cancer mortality. It's more frequently diagnosed in young women. So this is the age-specific rate of breast cancer in pink on the left. And you can appreciate for overall breast cancer, that peak where it kind of gets to the top of the mountain is around the 70s. Most women are more likely to get breast cancer as they get older. On the right is our inflammatory breast cancer registry coded by age. And what you can see is that the peak here is broad and it extends from the mid 30s until about 60. So it's a very different age range. And we're seeing patients even as young as 19. It's more represented in African-American women or Black women. And in our registry data with this red square, the percentage of Black patients who are under 40 is twice that of Caucasian patients. And that's even in our center where we are not well represented for underrepresented patients. One of the reasons why 30% of patients present with stage 4 disease is that the diagnosis is hard. I don't have any judgment when somebody comes and they've been misdiagnosed or had antibiotics. It is a hard diagnosis. And there are two aspects of it. First, you have to distinguish between inflammatory breast disease, so a person who doesn't actually have cancer, but they have breast skin changes, and inflammatory cancer. You've got to make the diagnosis of cancer. And then once a patient has a diagnosis of cancer, you've got to distinguish between regular non-inflammatory breast cancer and inflammatory breast cancer. And we see mistakes on both sides. We see patients not being able to get the diagnosis of cancer because someone's sure it can't be or that it's something else. And we see patients who come in who either they or their physician team didn't recognize it's inflammatory breast cancer or clearly saw all the signs and symptoms and said, I'm sure it's not, and here's why. And so there's a lot of room to improve that diagnosis piece. We have an algorithm for all cancer treatment at MD Anderson. It's publicly available. You could Google it at any time. And for the first time last year, we updated our IBC algorithm. So it actually includes that undiagnosed breast algorithm. How do you make the diagnosis of cancer? How do you get someone to take that seriously, get the biopsy that makes that diagnosis? And so anyone could access this at any time. You can just Google MD Anderson IBC algorithm. It is updated every few years and just see in a very comprehensive way, what are we doing for that? And Komen is currently finalizing a more patient-friendly portion of it. So there's a nice, easy infographic of how do I get this diagnosis if I'm being told it has to be an infection? Here's a look at sort of the complexity of just the page for undiagnosed breast cancer. And you can see at the top, this is page 5 of 19. So this is a resource if you wanted to know what are the next agents for first line, second line metastatic inflammatory breast cancer, or you wanted to look at our algorithm for how we deal with brain metastases. All of that is here and it's publicly available. You can just Google it. But focusing on this bit on the bottom, which is what Komen is working to make into an infographic, this is the piece where somebody comes with inflammatory symptoms. They have skin change, they have redness, they have breast swelling. Absolutely everybody needs breast imaging. That's step one. So the first piece is get that imaging. And then you can see it separates in the top or the bottom if the imaging's normal or it seems like there's a legitimate reason to think it's an infection. Okay, you suspect benign, you do antibiotics. And the next piece is critical. If it has not improved, you go on to this bottom box where you think, I'm worried that's malignancy. We need an MRI. We need a biopsy. If there's anything on the imaging, and another thing I see happen all the time is that people will have imaging that's called negative, but it actually has skin thickening. And that skin thickening is enough. that you probably need to go on to an MRI. So if you're talking with folks who need help getting that diagnosis, I hope this is a resource that helps people to advocate for themselves with their physicians or direct their physicians to it if, in fact, their physician's never seen it, which is very common. The second part of making the diagnosis that's hard is that once you have a cancer diagnosis, there's a lot of gray area about whether or not this is really inflammatory breast cancer or not. And that's in part because the staging system is a little too rigorous, too rigid. The AJCC staging system, which is the gold standard, requires diffuse erythema and edema. And the truth is, not everybody has erythema, and erythema does not look the same on everybody. So I think that's a big part of that. The International Breast Cancer Consortium worked hard to put together a diagnosis that's more flexible, that there's rapid onset of erythema and edema and or peau d'orange and or a warm breast, trying to really highlight that you don't have to have erythema for that. Yes, the onset is still fairly rapid. Yes, it does still have to be most of the breast. Having a little bit of redness over a mass is not IBC. Having redness that's away from the mass, that's most of the breast, that's IBC. Here are a couple of examples that just highlight how different it can look. On the top, these happen to be two patients who look like they have IBC, but they don't. One of these patients actually has an ovarian cancer that has metastasized to the breast and looks like IBC. So you can see that the left breast is larger, the nipple is asymmetric, the skin is discolored. On the MRI, there's real thickening here, but that's actually not IBC just because it's not breast cancer. On the second one, again, if you look at the MRI, you can really see that thick rind of skin. There's a lot of skin thickening here. The only reason this is not IBC is that this process has been going on for 2 years. So that's a locally advanced breast cancer that's not IBC. It's just too slow. In the middle are two patients who have what I would consider to be AJCC staged breast cancer. They both have erythema. They would meet the definition, and somebody who's heard of and knows what IBC is would say, yes, that's IBC. But at the bottom are two patients who maybe don't have classic AJCC erythema. The left breast in this E panel is clearly swollen. When you look at the imaging, there's thickened skin. When you examine this patient, you can see the edema in the skin, but they don't have imaging, and it would be easy to miss that patient. And the same with patient F. When you look at the left breast, again, there's really thick erythema or thick edema on the imaging, but there's not dramatic erythema here. And I think both of these are still accurately called IBC. So it's a tough diagnosis to make. What can we do about that? So Komen pulled together a group of interested and supportive organizations, the Milbourne Foundation and the IBC Research Foundation, and started to think about how do we make progress. And they wanted to develop an inclusive infrastructure to support the scientific committee and promote progress. They pulled together experts nationally. And I was a part of this. We sat down and said, what's the low-hanging fruit? What do we do first? And the first is, how do we improve diagnosis? And that work has led to this tool. It's now publicly available. You can go online and test it out, where you can actually enter in the criteria related to what you've noticed and some of the imaging things that you might need from your physician, or you can ask your physician to fill it out, and it will give a score. And what it said when it first went up was, this isn't validated. We all sat in a room and said, I would think this is IBC. These are critical things. It was clinician driven. And the next step then is to test it. Is it real? Is this the right thing? Can we validate it with data? And so Komen supported our team and also the Dana-Farber team led by Philippa Lentz. We both have dedicated inflammatory breast cancer programs to work together from our databases to say, can we test the score? And we ended up pulling together over 1,300 patients. They all had T4 staged. The Ds, T4D, are the inflammatory breast cancers, and the others are non-inflammatory, but suspicious. So it helps to compare, what if you had skin changes, but they weren't IBC? Can we come up with a score that really helps that? I know that if we compared them to patients who had stage 2 or stage 1 breast cancer, we'd actually see an even better performance, but we wanted to make it as hard as possible. We wanted it to pass a rigorous test. And so we pulled all these together. We worked, this was all funded by Komen. We worked for over 2 years on this and presented it at San Antonio. And here's basically a summary of the result. So if you look just at the graph, the patients who had IBC based on our opinion, and so we did it thinking, okay, this is the gold standard. If all of the clinicians involved said this is IBC, there's a good likelihood that it is. So on the left are all the patients who were staged as IBC. On the right are all the patients who were staged as T4, but not IBC. And the colors show us whether or not the score predicted that they were. So the highest scores, the very likelies, there are much more of those in the IBC group, and there are much more of the strong possibilities in the actual IBCs. But it's not perfect. There are still some that we thought were IBCs that got a weak possibility on the score and a couple that had very unlikely. That's much more true in the non-IBC group, that they got lower scores, and there were very few patients that got a very likely who we thought were definitely not IBC. So it's not perfect. But statistically, what this does tell us is that it is valid that if you had a higher score, there is a much higher chance that you have IBC. And so what does that help you with as a patient? Hopefully, it allows you to talk to your team and say, if there is uncertainty, how do I want to participate in these discussions about what therapy I have? Do I want to elect not to have a mastectomy, the standard therapy? Do I want to elect not to have an axillary lymph node dissection? If my score is that there's a strong possibility, but my team says, oh, I don't think so, how do we weigh that uncertainty into the decision process so that the patients really have the opportunity to make these decisions in the way that's best for their risk aversity? So the next step, of course, once you make a diagnosis is staging. All IBC patients are either stage 3 or stage 4. And as you heard, 30% of patients will be diagnosed stage 4 at the time that they present, that it has already spread beyond the breast because it's a fast-moving breast cancer and because it is slow to get diagnosed sometimes. The overall percent of the development of metastasis after treatment amongst patients who were stage 3 who when they arrived is dependent on the receptor status, and I'll show you those data. We see there's nothing's out of the question, but we commonly see metastases to the brain, to the lymph nodes, to the bone, to the lung, to the liver, to skin. The treatment goal for patients who have stage 4 is to find the best fit for their tumor, the best systemic therapy that's going to treat everything, the tumors that we know about, and any cells that are trying to start new tumors. And in a perfect world, that treatment would work so well that that patient achieves what we call stage 4 NED status, no evidence of disease. Typically, the way treatments work, metastatic, IBC or otherwise, is you take that treatment for as long as it works. And if something grows on that treatment, we switch to the next line. I just wanted to take a moment to highlight some patients that we've seen who kindly gave us permission to use their stories in an event we had last year when we accrued our 1,000th patient onto our IBC registry. This is Olivia Franz, super nice, lovely woman who was diagnosed really heartbreakingly right after the birth of her son at the age of 27. And she was diagnosed with stage 4 de novo breast cancer. And highlighting, and I'll talk about this, some of the advances in HER2 targeted therapy and the value of HER2 targeted therapy. She's currently NED, doing absolutely great, and really enjoying getting to watch her baby grow up. So certainly there are stories of hope, and I want to continue to highlight those as we talk about the risk of metastatic disease and the percentage of patients who are developing it, which is still much higher than is appropriate. So the risk depends on subtype. So we've recently tried to really dig into our registry data and focus on what are the results based on the treatment people are getting? What about the KEYNOTE-522 results? What about the regimens that they had before that? What's the benefit of carboplatin? Those kinds of things. And so looking at a contemporary cohort, we find that overall, close to 60% of patients ultimately develop metastatic disease. It's lower amongst patients who have a pathologic complete response. But one of the things that steals the value of that pathologic complete response is the risk of brain mets. And so we're seeing over a 20% risk of brain mets in patients with stage 3 triple negative breast cancer. And in the de novo stage 4 patients, that reaches over 30%. In the HER2 positive patients, there is more penetration into the brain from some of those drugs. And so you see an overall risk of developing brain mets is much lower in HER2, which is great. But in the de novo stage 4s, that risk again is over 30%. So that tells us we have got to make sure we're getting brain preventing drugs into the upfront setting to prevent that, and into the adjuvant setting for patients who aren't having a path CR. Our trial focus has got to be on brain penetration. So the greatest outcomes, the greatest improvement in outcomes has really come in HER2 positive. And that's been dominated by these drugs called the ADCs, the antibody-directed conjugates, like Kadcyla, like Enhertu. More of them are coming. You may know what these look like, but this is a graphic of a normal cell versus a HER2 positive cell, just as an example. And so a normal cell has some HER2 on the membrane. The cell has a nucleus in the middle that's kind of the control center, and then the membrane is the circle on the outside, and these little purple whales are basically these receptors called HER2. And when they're normally there, they're in charge of helping the cell know when to divide and act like a normal cell. And one of the reasons that HER2-positive breast cancer before the invention of Herceptin was such an aggressive and terrible breast cancer is that having this amplification of them, so many of them, is just constantly giving this signal, divide, 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 make more of yourself, grow, 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 grow and spread. And so that was a piece that is now target. So what Herceptin does is that it's an antibody, so it can recognize that protein on the surface and bind to it and stop it from telling the nucleus to divide and grow. So that's the value of Herceptin. It's the value of the other antibody-directed therapies. And it works in a cell where turning off Herceptin turns the cell off. The new thing that happened was people realized, well, I could take a cell that has a little bit of HER2 on it. It's not driven by that. I don't need to turn HER2 off because it's not misbehaving. But I could just use it as a flag where the antibody could now attach to that. And I could put something like any chemotherapy drug onto the end of that antibody, so I could kill that cell independent of whether or not it's driven by HER2. And so we see Kadcyla, we see Enhertu are drugs that work that way. They attach to the HER2, whether you have a little bit or a lot, and they deliver that cell killing therapy in a less toxic way because it's right there attached to the cell. But what that means is that you could find other proteins on normal cells that are on more on cancer than on other cells, and you could make this strategy work. And that's what's coming. And I think it's really exciting. So that's already happening in HER2 positive breast cancer. This is just one review from 2018. And in the bottom right-hand corner here, you can see the list of ADCs that were already even being tested there. And two of them that we just talked about, this is Kadcyla on the top, and then HER2 is the second one, are FDA approved. Here's the data that brought HER2 to clinic, just demonstrating overall survival from this agent, which is really an impressive success. And so that is going to continue to improve. Those drugs are going to continue to come. And I think it's a great source of optimism. This is just one of the ones that's relatively new and coming down the pipeline. It is not FDA approved yet, but it's quite promising. And there's even some data for the HER2 positive, ER positive specifically, which I think is also something to be really excited about. We have that as a part of an ongoing trial that's open at MD Anderson, but it's also open in other places. It's part of the I-SPY trial. So that's a good option for metastatic HER2 positive patients. But again, there are many of these ADCs that are coming, and hopefully they will really be a game changer for HER2 positive metastatic breast cancer. Of course, we have some folks who start with stage 3 breast cancer and ultimately develop metastatic disease. So this is Andrea Dean, who was diagnosed in 2018 and again gave us permission to share her story as a part of our event and our 1,000 patient event. And she developed IBC and went all the way through the treatment, had a pathologic complete response, and unfortunately, very quickly after that, developed brain metastases. So she's an example of that patient where the PCR is not as robust in IBC because there can be cells left behind. There can be cells that are protected in the brain. She's done absolutely great on TDM1, the Cadsilla, and HER2. And now 5 years after her initial diagnosis, she describes herself as almost NED and is doing well. So again, drugs really making a difference for complicated patients. For the metastatic triple negative breast cancers, looking at our data, we see that the Pembro, the Keytruda, that's a part of the neoadjuvant therapy now for triple negative breast cancer, is preventing triple negative metastases. So while those rates of metastatic disease are high, when we compare in the KEYNOTE-522 patients, they're coming down. So that's encouraging and tells us that there's value to immunotherapy in these patients. We know that there are ADCs for triple negative breast cancer that are on the market today. One of them is Trodelvy. And again, there will be more as this strategy is adopted to the targets that are on the triple negative tumors. There are also novel trials of alternative immunotherapies in development. I'll just share one mouse slide. This is some work from my lab, but there are many others who have shown this in different ways. And we basically took in A, IBC tumor cells and combined them with a special stromal cell called a mesenchymal stem cell. And we know that we can make the mice look like they have IBC. And then we either compared a control injection or an anti-macrophage injection. And what we find in B is that slows the tumor growth, but more importantly, it reverses that IBC looking phenotype in the skin and prevents it from coming back. And at the bottom, it's doing what it's supposed to be doing. The drug that blocks macrophages is blocking overall macrophages in D, and in E, it's blocking tumor-promoting macrophages. So we were excited about that, and that made us particularly excited when Dr. Lim showed us data from Baylor, where she spent a few years, but we're happy that we recruited her back. And this is Diego Pedroza's work in combination with Jeff Rosen and Sean Zhang. And they really studied this top drug in orange, which is Incyte's drug targeting macrophages with a low dose of a chemotherapy that's supposed to tweak the immune system a little bit, and then an anti-immune system, an anti-PD-1 drug on the bottom. And they were actually able to really cure some mice that have very hard to cure cancer. We talk all the time about, oh, it works in mice, but does it really work in patients? But some of the hard to cure things in mice aren't cured by the drugs and the studies. And so this was really encouraging, and we're excited that we're going to be able to bring this Insight trial in the next year for triple negative breast cancer and hope to be able to move some of that into the upfront setting soon. So what about ER positive patients? The ER positive patients right now, by and large, are taking the CDK4/6 inhibitors, so the Verzenio and the fulvestrant. And we wanted to understand for our metastatic patients, how well do they work? How much mileage are our patients getting out of those drugs? When we talked to our medical oncologists, their feeling was it doesn't feel like they're working as well, or they're able to just stay on them on cruise control for as long as they're seeing in the non-IBC patients. So we had 58 patients we were able to identify in our registry who were taking the adjuvant CDK4/6 inhibitors. And this included the one that first came out, the palbo, as well as ribociclib, and then the current one, abemaciclib, that more people are taking. And what they thought they were seeing is true. So in this group, we had 42 patients who started with stage 3 disease, developed mets, and then were put on this as a metastatic treatment. And we had 16 patients who had stage 4 de novo, and then were taking the CDK4/6 inhibitor at the time that they finished their surgery, if they had surgery. And the median time on treatment was 7 months. And the reason for changing treatment is progression. And that's a significantly shorter progression-free survival than was observed in the stage 4 ER-positive non-IBC patients that led to the FDA approval. And again, we were seeing, I think, for ER-positive disease, surprisingly more brain mets than we were expecting, with 12 out of 42 of these patients developing brain metastases. There are very exciting new drugs that are being tested now for ER-positive disease that I think will be very valuable for patients who have ER-positive disease that's not classically estrogen-driven, that are acting more like more aggressive breast cancers. And some of these are called ER degraders. So they're called SERDs, S-E-R-D, for estrogen receptor degrader. So some of the previous drugs were preventing estrogen from getting into the estrogen receptor so that it can't drive the cell. But here it's saying, let's just degrade the entire ER. Let's just shred it. So it doesn't matter if it's functioning in the nucleus. It doesn't matter if it's driving signaling on the membrane. We'll just degrade it. And there are even some encouraging signals for patients who have the estrogen receptor mutations that are tends to be resistant to the estrogen therapies. And so there's a lot of optimism that these are going to be good strategies moving forward for the more aggressive ER-positive breast cancers like IBC. So the conclusion, and these slides were presented by Bora Lim at San Antonio, the conclusion for future directions for ER positive is that the single agent oral SERDs in combination with the CD4K6, they gave it with palbociclib, was safe. For some of these drugs, they're seeing efficacy across regimens and disease settings. So even when other things haven't worked, they're seeing early efficacy in patients who've had previous chemotherapy. They're seeing some evidence of blood-brain barrier penetration. So getting to that really key issue of trying to prevent people from getting metastases, but also being able to treat metastases. And they were able to determine the dose so that they can move those forward into next studies. So that's fantastic too. So a first conclusion, and then I just have a couple more slides about sort of next steps. Immunotherapy, the ADCs and the novel ER degraders, I think, are really promising new therapies for metastatic IBC. Brain mets prevention is really critical. That's got to be our focus of surveillance. It's got to be our focus for trials. How are we making sure that we're getting drugs that are getting into the protected brain site to prevent metastases and then also providing better treatments? We need to, as clinicians, all have a really low threshold during surveillance for imaging the brain and treating as quickly as possible. It's critical to understand how to integrate liquid biopsies into this. And I'm going to talk about that for just a second, because I think there's a lot of hope. It's not there yet, but there's a lot of hope that this could be a way that we can understand who has this risk and how do we find it sooner. And certainly we continue to need more work to understand and target the unique biology of IBC, and I'll talk about that for a second. So this is just a slide from a relatively famous, well-cited review about MRD, minimal residual disease. And it's really talking about whether or not you can identify patients who, you know, seem like they've had a complete response, but still actually have disease there. And can we use it to predict that there's going to be a relapse and do something about it before that? So in the clinical setting, that's the goal, is tracking real-time insight of disease burden. This is a study, and I'm not gonna go into the data because it's Dr. Lucci's data, but this is a study of the trial that's going on at MD Anderson. They are enrolling all stage 1 to 4 patients into their registry to look at both CTCs and ctDNA and understand what is the percentage of patients who have it. So they're getting blood at the time point the patients have a neoadjuvant therapy, right in the middle. So you can see, is it responding? And in triple negative patients, there was a nice study demonstrating that ctDNA tracks with whether or not patients are going to get a path CR. They're getting another sample at surgery to ask, does that relate to path CR? And then they're getting post-op blood draws at 6 months and 1 year to say if there's still CTCs or ctDNA there, which one is better? Does one of them really tightly correlate to whether or not there's going to be an event? Do we find them even in patients who have path CR? Would that help us to know which patients should take adjuvant therapy or which patients should take different adjuvant therapy? And moving that into long-term follow-up. And so they are pulling together all of the data for the IBC patients. They have over 100 IBC patients they have data for. What they find is at the very beginning of treatment, about 2/3 of patients have either CTCs or cell-free DNA. And neither one of them alone paints a completely clear picture. Yes, this is the tool that tells us we can predict who is going to have a recurrence. But by putting them together, they are beginning to get some understanding of what's the right time frame and can it predict for what's going to happen so that we can begin to think about how do we do that and act on it? And the real question and the reason we aren't drawing them now clinically is the question is what to do about it. Do you change the therapy you're on, or is that therapy you're on going to help to eliminate that? So that's where we are. As a program, we have developed a new platform called IBC Metamorphosis. And it is a unique platform to really pull together a collection of translational studies to address this question of better understanding the transcriptomics and the biology and the genomics of inflammatory breast cancer so that we can design the best trials possible and partner with people like Dana-Farber, who are also bringing really great innovative trials that we're delighted to be working with them on, and really to support and provide infrastructure to develop these priorities and be efficient about it and crank this stuff out as fast as we possibly can to provide better trials. So here's just a list of some of the translational trials that fall into this bucket that we're currently doing to try in a really massively parallel way, generate this data across the spectrum of inflammatory breast cancer disease. Here's a zoomed in look just at the IBC landscape trials, which are really about biopsies and genomics. And I'm going to highlight the Boston Gene partnership that we've made. If you haven't heard of Boston Gene, they have a clinically approved, FDA-approved biopsy-based study where they can sequence the tumor and provide some insight about what mutations might be there, what are the unique things about a person's individual tumor that would help to pick therapies. And so we have partnered with them. They've agreed to do analysis on all of our IBC patients, whether they have stage four disease or not. And this is the very preliminary look at that overview from 44 samples that we've ordered so far. The top two things tell us that very few patients have a high tumor mutational burden. That means that they're not like melanoma patients where the immunotherapies are working so much better than what we're seeing. 100% had a stable microsatellite status. This is another thing where across some cancers, patients have microsatellite instability. It opens the door to a particular drug. We're not seeing that here. But we are seeing that a lot of patients have oncogenic mutations. Some of them are certainly actionable. Over here on the other side, we see that 40% have an immune-enriched phenotype. So I hope that means that we can personalize more about which patients are going to respond to immunotherapy. Almost nobody has a luminal A breast cancer. So we knew our ER positive patients weren't acting like friendly ER positives, and we don't see that group there. And over 60% had at least one high RNA-seq expression targetable surface gene, which is exciting because those are the places where we have drugs. I'm going to skip this one and just highlight. These show you the tumor portrait. So you've got 14 that were immune desert. They're just not likely to respond to immunotherapy. But the percentage of patients that will is higher than I think we had guessed. And down at the bottom, that high expression of surface target genes, 30% of them should respond to the anti-PD-L1 drugs. The second one listed here, the folate receptor, there's an ADC for that. So I hope that this will help us move forward to really connecting patients to drugs that are going to make a big difference for them. So second conclusions, I think there are many opportunities on the horizon for metastatic inflammatory breast cancer. The tumor portraits can provide actionable biology that helps us both to guide treatment, but also to design better trials. Liquid biopsies are not yet changing care, but there is great acceleration and technology in this space. And I think that it's only going to grow. And of course, we need to continue to understand the complexity of biology of IBC, and the work that's going on in the lab is really, really critical. So with that, I just want to say thank you to all of the patients and their family members who've allowed us to learn from them, to all of the team at the IBC program where I work, to the Komen team for what they're doing for IBC, which we're so, so grateful for, many, many funding agencies. And I wanted to just tell you, we have a boot walk every year. It's a fundraiser. That's not the point of this QR code. We have a team, the IBC Wranglers, and anybody is welcome to join. You do not have to donate or fundraise, but you could walk virtually if you want to. And if you want to connect with other IBC patients and be a part of that group, please feel free to join us and walk wherever you are. So thank you so much, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Woodward, for that really super interesting presentation. One question that came in, and I know we can't give, you know, specific advice to any single patient, but you spoke about brain metastasis and the importance of surveillance and prevention trials, and potentially in a related question, for somebody with leptomeningeal metastasis, would you also recommend sort of looking at trials, or kind of what is your general stance in those sort of cases?
Sure. I think leptomeningeal disease is one of the most difficult diagnoses in all of breast cancer right now. For the HER2 positive patients, we are seeing that there is penetration from some of those agents. And so I think we all have a lot of optimism that we'll see some benefit from that. When there are clear physical symptom deficits from it, so if it, and leptomeningeal disease, if anyone hasn't heard of it, is having breast cancer on the surface of the brain as opposed to having a clear sort of tumor nodule in the brain itself. And the reason why that is perhaps a more difficult thing with a more challenging outcome is that the cells can even float in the fluid around the brain and the spinal cord, so that if we radiated the brain, for example, those cells that are floating around could just float back in, and some others could float down and end up on the spinal cord somewhere. So radiation isn't as effective. We do use radiation if it has sat down and caked onto the nerves that are working the eyes or the face, and we can reduce and push back some of those symptoms. People put sometimes a thing called an Ommaya reservoir into the fluid, which is a way to inject chemotherapy into that space. There is a phase 2 study from Memorial Sloan Kettering that demonstrated that proton cranial spinal irradiation, so using protons, which don't go in one side and out the other, they're much more focused radiation, which makes it safer to treat the brain and all of the spinal cord without having dose coming into the abdomen and everywhere else. And they were able to show that by radiating it all, they were able to improve overall survival, which is a pretty astounding accomplishment for such a challenging space. And it was a very small number of patients. So there are many trials, and we have one, but I'm sure there are many in other places where people are doing protons, trying to figure out what to combine that with. How do we make it even better? So there's interest in that. The challenge for many places is the delay to get to protons is not worth that time. So that's a real challenge for that. The maybe most exciting up and coming thing for leptomeningeal disease is that there is a recent FDA approval of a radioactive molecule that's an injectable. It's a liquid. And it is, I'm not sure if I can pronounce what it's called. I'll have to come back to that. But they have some exciting preliminary work putting something that could float around, would attach to the tumor cells, and actually just treat them with a really local close bit of radiation, reducing that toxicity and providing some better outcomes. So I hope that that will bring us some good news and that the FDA will extend and expand that, that option.
Great. Thank you so much. You mentioned the partnership with Boston Gene. And just wondering, you know, we talk about sort of diversity in our data, in our trials. Do you have a sense of representation for that partnership?
I don't know that yet for that partnership. From our internal registry data, we have a partnership with Gay Devi at Duke, which is looking at the aspect of IBC, which is a health disparity, and really intentionally making sure that every sample we have from an unrepresented patient is included in our data set. I'll tell you that we have shifted our approach to pathology and samples, which is where we used to have a practice where if you wanted samples, you could put in a request and we'd send you 10 samples or 15 samples or something. And instead of doing that now, we're working really hard to get all of the tissue into cohorts of meaningful, similar patients. What treatment did you get? Do we know the outcomes? And actually generate the data and share the data. So that's one piece, is that internally, I hope that we will soon have a really robust data set that's inclusive of all of those things. On the Boston gene, they certainly are connected to, I mean, they're offering a treatment all over, and they are connected to many of our partners. And so my hope is as we begin to pull that together, we can partner with people. I know Dr. Ueno in Hawaii has talked with them. We can partner to people in places where more underrepresented patients would have access, and really do a good job of trying to diversify that data as well. But I've not yet, this is like literally hot off the press. I haven't seen, I couldn't even tell you which of those patients have ER.
Great. A question from our audience on sort of, you know, the average lifespan of somebody living with stage four, and they're particularly asking about hormone positive, HER2 negative, but I don't know if you sort of have seen any updated statistics around stage four survival.
Yeah, I hesitate to tell you a number until we really have finalized those data. But what I will say trend-wise is that while the risk of recurrence is high and while the progression on the standard therapies is high, there are still lots of options. And so the overall survival is much better than the progression-free survival. So what that tells me is that people are living with metastatic ER-positive breast cancer, and taking, I assume, therapies for that, but that it is not that the overall survival for that ER-positive patient is so much diminished compared to some of these other difficult situations.
Great. Let's see. I mean, you spoke a little bit about this in your talk in terms of, you know, significant treatments that are available now that weren't available even 5 years ago. And you talked about the ADCs, you know, and some of the other immunotherapies and some other things. Is there any sort of anything you didn't mention that that we might be able to talk about?
There's certainly investigator-initiated studies across all of those spaces. We are really interested in whether or not we could get the capivasertib oral AKT inhibitor to be incorporated into the adjuvant space, and optimistic that that has some brain penetration as well. But I think still the best thing is whatever the center near you that has a good clinical trial portfolio is to look at what are the new agents that they're bringing in, and try to get someone to help you rank them for your specific disease situation.
And in terms of patients, is there anything in terms of support that you find patients benefit from most?
I think that on one piece of that is making use of all of the resources or finding the resources if you're not in a center or a location where those are available. And by that, I mean things like managing all of the side effects from that care. So the lymphedema specialist who's in physical therapy, the integrative medicine center, massage, acupuncture, radiation, fibrosis. We have new data still emerging, but I've had a number of patients who've had good relief from tightness and scar tissue with Botox injections. And so the physical medicine and rehab team can evaluate whether or not you're likely to benefit from it, and be able to do that so that the muscle that's spasming or contracting actually relaxes, and then you can get a full stretch and really improve that range of motion, which can last longer than the 3 months that the Botox lasts in some case, because then you're really able to stretch it. I've also had folks have nerve blocks and lidocaine injections into pain and things that are hurting for those kinds of things. I think really valuable to connect with supportive care, but also recognize that supportive care and hospice care to a certain degree are very variable by your location. And so whatever you can do to connect with people who have some real experience or knowledge is probably useful to be thinking about the hard questions, right? How do we face end of life decisions when that clearly becomes inevitable and we really are ready to say, okay, how do I navigate this in the way that I want to have control over it and answer questions about where do people want to pass? Where is it at home? Is it in hospice? Is there a hospice that really can offer that kind of support and comfort and make that go well? And I think there's some value in when a person is ready, finding the time to dig into some of those things so that you can exert some control over it and really make that as ideal as it could possibly be for both you and your family. So some of those kinds of things, I think resources too, like the IBC Research Foundation, the IBC Network, the amazing network of advocates who can help talk through clinical trials, pros and cons, where are they available? Is it worth traveling for? And I'd also just highlight too that there are opportunities to get help traveling to a trial, and it's always worth it to ask if you've found one and it's just not something that you have the resources to get to. Is there an opportunity that somebody could help? Because there are some resources, our institution does that. And so some of those kinds of things too.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Woodward, for your presentation. And thank you everyone who joined us. And at this point, I can turn it back over to Casey to wrap things up. Thanks again.
Thanks so much.
All right, guys. So a special thank you to Dr. Woodward and Jamie for facilitating a really important discussion for us all today. We've got a couple thank yous and thanks a lot. This was a great talk in the chat. If you guys didn't see it, I wanted to make sure I pointed it out. So for our attendees, today's session was recorded and will be posted to our landing page and our YouTube channel soon. Since you registered, you'll get it right to your inbox. So please help us spread the word about this content with your friends, your families, healthcare professionals, anybody you think would be interested and could benefit from this talk today. So one last time, I've got to thank our sponsors for the MBC Impact Series. Because of their support, we're allowed to and able to bring these important topics directly to you every month. So thank you to GE Healthcare, AstraZeneca, Merck, and Gilead, and then also Walgreens and Daiichi Sankyo. All right, also, I put the link in the chat, and I apologize, I'm getting a little fumbly today. That is our feedback survey. So please let us know how we did today, but also topics that are of interest to you for the future. This is really how we design our programming. It's up to you guys to tell us what's important and valuable so that we can do our best to bring that to you. So take a moment, it only takes a minute, and I personally see all the results, so it means a lot to me. Our next MBC Impact Series event is May 28th, and we'll be focused on metastatic lobular breast cancer. You can register now on our landing page, komen.org/MBC series. So we hope to see you there. Thank you for joining today. Thanks for everyone for participating, and stay safe and stay connected.